I get to know. Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. You guys are definitely more talkative than last service, and I'm a little bit more awake for this service too. So the reason, part of the reason that I'm the only one up here, I'm gonna dime my siblings out a little bit. So I was a babysitter last night, and so I decided to let the kids kind of choose when to go to bed, and they didn't go to bed until very late, extremely late. And so when I tried to wake them up this morning, it was like 7 a.m. or something. I like went and turned on the living room light because they all crashed in the living room. And I'm like, okay, guys, time to get up. And nobody budged. And it was just dead silent. I'm like, all right, doing it alone this morning then. So I went and I'm up here all alone. And we're going to go through this, though. So this first one is open the eyes of my heart. So you guys can stand if you want. Do whatever you want.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up. I'm shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Can I have the ushers come forward to receive the offering? So I don't know if you guys are going to know this next one. It's more of a newer song. It's called To My Knees. But I learned this before I went on the women's retreat, and it has been a favorite worship song of mine. It's just, it's a beautiful song. So hope you guys catch on.
The Savior's love, I find joy beyond compare. Endless peace covers all of me. When you breathe within, you turn winter into spring. It dissolves every fear in me. To my knees, brings me to my knees. My King forever, you are all my heart desires until the end of time. My soul surrenders. My vacant heart, Lord, you came and made a home. You bring light to the dark in me. When I lose my way, I am beckoned into grace. You alone are my everything. To my knees, brings me to my knees. My King forever, you are all my heart desires until the end of time. My soul surrenders. All the earth sing a mercy never ending. I will worship with all that is within me. Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, King of heaven, yours is the glory. I will worship with all that is within me. Holy, holy, yours is the glory. Cause your love brings me to my knees, brings me to my knees. My King forever, you are all my heart desires until the end of time. My soul surrenders. All the earth sing a mercy never ending. I will worship with all that is within me. Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, King of heaven, yours is the glory. I will worship with all that is within me. King of heaven, yours is the glory. Cause your love brings me to my knees, brings me to my knees. My King forever, you are all my heart desires until the end of time. My my soul surrender.
So this next song, you guys are gonna know this one. I was a counselor actually for 3 weeks. And when you're working with middle school kids, trying to get middle school kids to kind of listen to God and enter in and all that stuff can be kind of difficult sometimes. And I was leading worship there, and I'm with a brand new group of people up on stage. We've been practicing and everything, but you can practice all you want, but errors still happen when you sing and you worship. But after one of the services, we were called up there to do one more song, and this was the song, Greater You, Lord. And we got up there, and you have all these little kids sitting up here, all these middle school kids and everything. And for some reason, it was like we became instruments. The people on stage, we weren't, it was like God was using us, like he was playing through us. He was using us to portray a message, because it was like a flawless performance. It was just beautiful. We were just singing, and it was like this electric feeling in the air. And it wasn't us, because humans are erred, but that was a beautiful, perfect moment. And there was all these little middle school boys down there, and they were just bawling. And it was just like, you don't see middle school boys, you know, bawling. And that night, there was these kids that were just like in tears, and they were for a good 30 minutes. And that night, quite a few of them ended up giving their lives to Jesus and deciding to get baptized. And I got the chance to witness to a little girl, and I got to baptize her later on that week. And after that, this song meant so much more, because it was just like, you know, we all go through those crazy moments where we, you know, forget that God's real and all this stuff, or, you know, if he's there with us. But, you know, the song talks about God being our breath and our lungs. And I just want you guys to kind of think about that, you know, just take a deep breath, any stress from the week, any struggles, just take a deep breath and kind of, you know that God's there, and that if you just let him take over, you let him use you as an instrument, you will be used in ways that you never thought was possible. And here we go.
You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, you only. You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We'll pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you, only. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you. In our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Dear Lord, God, I know that you've created us all differently, Lord, with all different callings in our life, and some of us haven't reached those. Maybe a lot of us haven't reached those, Lord. A lot of us are still trying to figure out what you have for us, Lord. But I pray that you will help us to not be hindered by struggles or stresses that you put in our life, because God, I know you are trying to help us find the trail that leads to what you have put before us, God, the blessings that you have put before us, Lord. And I pray that you will just help us to just continue opening our hearts to you, continue opening our minds and our bodies to you, Lord, and just let us become more open to you, Lord. Let us help you, you know, use us as an instrument. Use us to minister to other people. Use us to show people that, you know, you are the light. You are our strength. You are our wisdom, God, and you are what is going to guide us through the darkness when we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, Lord. And God, I pray that you will just put a kind of a breath of life into our hearts right now and our lungs, God, and just help us to take a deep breath, Lord. And I pray that you will just help us to walk out of church today, God, knowing that you have our backs and that you love us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
So I had to say this for last service. But I'm really thankful for Sophia to sit here and come up here and do worship for all of us, despite having her sisters back down on her. Oh, there you guys are. They're coming. Okay, so first things first, I'm not Pastor Jeff. I just want to make that clear, and we'll get to that. But Pastor Jeff asked me, as you guys probably know, he's not going to be here for this whole month of August. So he's asked some of us to come up and give some sermons. So I'm who you're stuck with for today. That's what I'm saying. One quick thing for you youth. You are not dismissed. You have to be here. You're stuck with me. So sorry, guys. Just how it has to be. Okay, now before we get launched into things, we have a few announcements. So come over here. Some men's ministry announcements, right?
Men's ministry announcements. Wow. I was able to give the announcement this morning, and two times in a row, worship was just amazing, and God is always faithful to show up if we're faithful to go ahead and be there where he's calling us to. And for the men's ministry, we're working consistently at inviting you guys to come on out to events that we're working on each and every month. What it's really about is us focusing on Christ, what he's doing in our lives, and men being stronger together. And when we get together, we tend to do push-ups and have a lot of fun and goof off with one another. But in the midst of it, God is always doing something amazing. I was showing up this morning. I don't like getting up very early. But, you know, I'm prepared to be all jokey. And a brother shared something he's going through. And I was just thinking, you know, it's always so much bigger than whatever we think it is. And that's why when there's a ministry that's centered on you, it's a great opportunity for you to come out and maybe focus a little more on something that's bigger than yourself. Now, then maybe that's a big thing to say. One of the things I learned early in my walk is that you need to be involved in some capacity, because a person on an island, I mean, they're isolated, right? And that's the worst place to be. And so every month we have something going on. So this Saturday is men's breakfast. Yeah, food. And so we got biscuits and gravy plans, scrambled eggs, homemade corned beef hash. Another guy was talking about making sausage links. Everybody always brings donuts, so there'll be like 3 donuts per guy. And it's a great way to get to know some more people. Maybe we get to see you, know you, and we can also pray for one another. So that's this Saturday coming up, the 19th, 8 a.m. So it'll be 8 to 10 a.m. Next month is kind of our big hurrah. Next month, September 15th, 16th, 17th, is a men's camp out. So we're going to be camping that weekend, where, of course, we're going to have a lot of food. We're going to do some kung fu. I'm serious. And we're going to fish, and we're going to have fun, and there'll be secret guy stuff. Yeah, we're not telling anybody. So you're going to have to show up. Eric, you're invited. Okay. And so that's going on next month. October 14th, we're going to be doing men's bowling right here at the Cottage Bowl. Now, if you missed out last time, it'll be at 5 p.m., and we were doing all kind of jokes. You get to see Richard New tiptoe like a ballerina and bowl at the same time. It was a sight to behold, beautiful, and we all remember it. And afterwards, we're going to go have chimichangas. Once again, that's right, El Tapatio. So we're going to go, and we're just going to mob up in there and eat all the Mexican food. It's really righteous. And so anyways, so this Saturday coming up, men's breakfast. Next month, that weekend, 15th, 16th, 17th, camping site. We're still kind of working on that. That's a work in progress. It's not as easy as you think, right? And so, and then we're going to bowl. And then after that, we're not sure. So, but we're planning out. God bless you. Thank you.
I don't know. It seems like, in my experience, Mexican food does kind of funny things to you, especially if you overeat too much a little bit. That sounds fun. Oh, chicken. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So I got a PowerPoint. We can maybe get up on the slide here. But I do have a couple more announcements really quick. Nick, want to make sure I mention this. August 27th, you know, last Sunday of every month, we always have outdoor service, right? So don't forget, outdoor service, the 27th. So don't come here. Come there, Corner Park, 1045. Okay. Also, Ben Corson's going to be teaching. That'll be the last time, I think, before Pastor Jeff comes back in September. So just to let you guys know. Another thing here is, I think there's a lot of youth in here. There's this awesome rafting trip coming up that I'm sure you guys have seen the flyers around, August 26th. It's going to be great right before that outdoor service. I've grown up, my family's taken me rafting, and rafting is just a blast, and you're out there in the rapids. It's really a team-building thing, because you're trying not to flip over, and you're trying to survive while you're working together, hopefully. Otherwise, things happen. But the thing is, we're going to be in a section of the Rogue River, I guess, that's a little bit quieter than, like, say, this kind of thing. So you're going to be seeing a little bit more of, like, that, which certainly is relaxing for some. But for those who are young and want thrills, this could be a little boring. So what you really want to do is you want to add something to it. And this is what you want to add. Water fights are an excellent part of rafting. You get like 3-4 rafts out there. You got some nice wars going on. It's awesome. But I'm going to make some quick suggestions. So ultimately, I'm suggesting that you bring water guns, okay, youth that are going. that one is the one you want. It's called the Stream Machine. It's the perfect just dipstick, pull in the water, and just hose everyone kind of one. Please don't get the double barrel ones. They look cool, but they're just not going to work for you. You're trying to push too much water out. Don't do that. Also, don't get the stupid little pump ones. People are going to laugh at you as you squirt them with the tiny little stream. And then finally, just don't do these. Just you're going to, yeah, okay. So I'd say get some water guns, and I really even suggest if you don't have a stream machine, they're kind of like $16, but I would say it might be worth it to pay $16 for one of these things because it's really a blast to have a water gun. You don't want to be the single youth person out there without a water gun getting hosed by everyone. So just want to point that out. Okay, enough of that. So Pastor Jeff, when he asked me to teach, said I could do a topical study. I could choose something. So I was like, okay. Well, last time I taught was January 1st, New Year's Day, and I kind of went off the idea of love. Agape love was the topic I chose. And I really kind of wanted to hit that again. I was like, you know, it seems like everything keeps coming back down to love. It seems like that's such a great thing to choose. I ended up doing a little thinking about what I had been thinking about recently. I thought actually something more appropriate would be to focus in on perspective. I have this picture of the planet Earth there because the idea is to consider the bigger picture instead of focusing in on our small details, the trivial matters of our lives is ultimately where this goes. So if you have Bibles, the passage we're going to be looking at is 1 Thessalonians 5. Now, does anyone not have a Bible? Because we can totally get you one. Yes. Okay, cool. I'm going to get you one. Right? Okay, sweet. Anyone else? No? Okay. Sweet. Okay. Anyway, while you guys go and flip there, for efficiency's sake, I'm going to go and keep talking a little bit. I was told I should probably introduce myself, so I'm going to talk a little bit about myself. On January 1st, I talked about myself, but there weren't too many people there. A lot of you guys just know me as that kid that plays keyboard, I'm sure. So I'll describe myself a little bit more. First off, I'm a Beaver. I'm sorry, that might disappoint some of you. there's a lot of Duck fans around here. But I go to Oregon State University. I have for the last couple years. And I've only got one more term, fall term, before I hopefully graduate with a mechanical engineering degree. So we'll see. Yeah. Ugh. Okay. So I've had a lot of fun, a lot of stress, a lot of assignments and projects and trying to make things work with the engineering major. So it's been interesting. But in addition to that, I've also been painting. That's not me, by the way, but that is usually what I end up doing because we usually put in pairs when we paint stuff. My coworker likes to roll everything, so I'm stuck with the brush, cutting in everything. So that's another thing I do, doing full-time here over the summer. You guys already know I'm big into music. I play piano, play keyboard, and such like that. I like to say I kind of play drums. I might be able to fool a lot of people into thinking that I play drums, but I'm really not very good at it. So I should just say I play piano. All right, but I'm big into music. And finally, the last couple years, I've been living at a fraternity, a Christian fraternity. So it's all kosher, of course. You know, there's bad name for fraternities and such. But it's been hard to get used to because there's 60 other guys. I'm kind of more of an introvert. So living with 60 other guys was certainly something to figure out how exactly to adjust to that. But there's also, there's these things called sleeping porches. Anyone heard of sleeping porches? Maybe? Yeah? Okay. They're, you know, you're with 30 other guys, you're sleeping in the same room. You know, you got your own bunk beds and such, but interesting stuff. Ultimately, though, over the last couple years and stuff, I've stayed pretty busy with all these events, all these things going on, which perhaps is good, but there is a downside to it that I've noticed, which is kind of what this message is about. When I have band practices, when I have all these events, I'm going from one thing to the next, just kind of going back and forth because I got to do that. Got to go to Corvallis to paint. Got to do school. Got to stress out. Well, don't have to stress out about that, but got to deal with that, do this and such. You get to the end of the day, and you're doing all these like maybe mundane tasks, and I realize, wait a minute, I have not thought about God at all today. I haven't thought about why I'm here, what I'm doing. I haven't thought about the big picture. I'm so focused in on these little details of my busy life, perhaps. I don't remember what's my purpose here. And so that's kind of what the focus here is on exactly. Just kind of like this guy, if you can see what's going on. This guy is walking through this golf field with these sprinklers on. He thinks it's raining, and he's like complaining about it. But if you just take a look at the bigger picture, you realize it's just sprinklers. No. So sometimes the things that are trivial, we don't realize just how trivial they are. Anyway, so you're all in 1 Thessalonians, right? Hopefully, yes. Awesome. Cody, you're there. Good. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get there. Go ahead and follow me. I'm just going to read through verses 1 through 5. It says, "But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. But when they say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness." Now, it talks mostly in here in this first passage about the coming of the Lord and us being awake and aware of it. But it talks here, too. It mentions a lot about light and dark. And, you know, when you read the Bible, there's a lot of stuff, it seems, that Hollywood likes to grasp onto and take from the Bible, ideas and such. And so when you think about light and dark, or light side and a dark side, probably guess where I'm going. Sorry, it always comes back to Star Wars. It's just like the best thing. Okay. Anyway, we have like a light side and a dark side in Star Wars. Unfortunately, it's not quite the same thing as the dark side in Star Wars, comparison to this. We're talking about, like, if you're on the dark side, you're more like this guy. It's kind of like a selfish and evil thing. It's all about you. That's not exactly what this is talking about in the darkness. Are you raising your hand, Sonny? Oh, that was a stretch. Okay, let me a little confused there. Okay. No, what they're actually talking about in this is about being blind, sort of like this guy who's blindfolded. Now, a lot of you guys are aware of this. In second service, you know, you get to the end of service, right? Pastor Jeff's been talking, and you start to hear, right? I've never actually been down here for that, so I don't know what it sounds like, but I hear that apparently there are sounds that emanate from up there. Is that generally true? Okay, apparently it's quite distracting. I try to, like, tell the youth, like, please take lighter steps, but it doesn't usually do anything. Anyway, that's because of the youth games we do. So I usually make the youth games for second service here up in the youth room. So I get to have a lot of fun coming up with stuff that I get to torment all you guys with, games and such. A lot of them, though, ultimately have to do with getting some of the youth blindfolded. There's a lot of variations of this, but generally the idea is that some of the youth are blindfolded in these games, and the rest aren't. And usually the idea is that the blindfolded youth have to tag the non-blindfolded youth. It's kind of usually how it goes. But what I've noticed sometimes is that the blindfolded youth will just kind of meander into one corner of the room. And so, of course, all the non-blindfolded youth will be stuck on the other side, just kind of laughing at them. And they'll be sitting there just feeling the wall and such in each other's faces. But they're, like, obsessed with this one area of the room. But no one's there. There's no point for them being there. What they're doing is purposeless, but they don't know that because they're blindfolded. They're in the darkness. And so that's kind of the trouble with being in the darkness. We don't really know what's actually important. We can think what is important is a big deal, but it's not. So let me quickly move on here. Verses 6 through 7, go and follow with me. Just read this again. It says, "Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. Those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night." Now, it's talking about being asleep or being drunk or being awake. Kind of the same idea of being in the darkness. And certainly if you are not a Christian, you're not a believer, then you are in the darkness. You don't know what's going on. You're not awake to what's really, really happening. But that isn't to say, though, that as a Christian we can't be asleep too and kind of forget what the bigger picture is, what's important. So the big question then at this point is, well, are we asleep then? Because certainly there are lots of things to help us get there. We have a lot of things in this world that could certainly distract us. I mean, look at all this stuff. I had to bring this up last service because I found that picture. You see those cute puppies up there? I'm not a fluffy creature guy, but those things are just like, you know, you want to pet them and hug them. I mean, you just want to hug all three, just like, anyway. There are certainly lots of distractions, is what I'm saying. You can just take your pick out of things you want to choose. That nice car, for instance. Netflix is a big one, I think. I always hear about people talking about, oh, binge-watching that show on Netflix or that all those movies they have on it, right? I mean, Netflix is a big deal. I'm sure a lot of you watch Netflix, right? You don't have to raise your hand, I guess. I mean, it's not like it's bad. It's just, you know. But certainly, like, Lost is my show, right? I get into Lost quite a bit. And it's easy to go binge-watch something, and pretty soon you find that your focus, your perspective is a little bit different. You're sitting there thinking in the middle of the day, you're thinking, wait a minute, Sally just proposed to George, but George just died. But what is Tom going to do now that happened? Like, wait, is Sally going to go that way? You know, wait, didn't Tim just like kill Steve? And, you know, you start thinking about all the soap opera stuff. I'm not a soap opera guy. I want to make that clear, first of all. although maybe there's some drama shows I watch. But, you know, when our day-to-day mindset is suddenly, is Tom going to marry Sally? It's kind of like, wait a minute. Where are we in this world? It's like, okay, so we have this Savior who loves us so much, who created us. Like, shouldn't we be focusing on that? But it's so easy to take these distractions and suddenly latch onto those, and then you get stuck with fads and all that, and you don't think about the bigger picture. And often a side effect of that is when you hear people vent or you hear a lot of complaining, usually that's evidence that someone's got this kind of narrowed perspective. They're not considering the big picture. Israel is an excellent example of this when they're going through the desert. Because when we think about Israel's trek through the desert, their 40-year journey, you often think about how much they complained, right? Seems like that's what we always take away from it. And I have to give them that traveling through the desert for 40 years cannot be enjoyable, fun. I wouldn't necessarily like that. I'm sure none of you guys would like that. But they did have their food taken care of, although they complained about their lack of varied meals. They had their water taken care of. But most importantly, they were the chosen people of God, which perhaps if they realized that, they kept that in mind, they would be much more thankful for their position. And they would be less complaining, you could say, about the trivial matters that they were dealing with ultimately. So it's very easy, though, and I have to say this, you can look at characters in the Old Testament like Samson and go, what is wrong with you? Like, why aren't you thinking clearly? And children of Israel go like, why do you have to complain about everything? And I'm good. I got some water. I'm good. I might be smacking a little. Okay. But you can look at these people and think, well, the children of Israel are so complaining. I would never be like that. Like, that's ridiculous. I'm not like that. That's a little dangerous to do because we can just take a honest look at yourself and realize, yeah, we can be kind of venti complaining at times. Just yesterday, I was cutting the cheese for a quesadilla, a couple of quesadillas for lunch. And I was sitting there, and I was cutting the cheese with a Swedish cheese cutter. That's always what I like to use. But I was thinking to myself, I was kind of griping to myself because the cheddar block was only an inch high, so I was having a hard time, like, grasping it and also cutting the cheese without, like, cutting myself. So I was like, oh, I want to deal with this. So I should just, like, throw it away. And I was kind of thinking to myself, are you serious? Like, you know, I'm loved by the creator of the heavens, the earth, and the universe, and he wants to have a relationship with me, this whole big deal thing, and I'm complaining about having a hard time cutting a cheddar block that's an inch high. It's very easy for us to get into that mindset, get into the mundane. That's where I've been going with that. Now let's go ahead and move on. We're going to go into verses 7 through 11, like I have there. So go ahead and follow along with me. It says, for those who sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Which it's nice to know that we could still be asleep and be in the darkness and we're still saved. Salvation doesn't depend on that. So I want to point that out. And verse 11 says, therefore comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. So in this section, we're getting a lot about armor, putting on armor. So it's like, what exactly do they mean by that? Well, you got to first ask yourself, what is armor for exactly? So this dude, for instance, knight in shining armor. He's got all this plate armor, right? Well, what does that do for him? Well, that helps him so that when some guy shows up with a lance or a spear or a sword and decides he wants to, like, strike him through, he can just be like, no way, and just, like, chest bump the sword out of the way, and he's good. He's fine. He's defended. That's the point of armor, right? So the question now is, what are we defending against? Well, we're talking a lot about being awake and being sober because it can be difficult for us to get stuck asleep or get caught up in the things of the world, get stuck in the things of the world, and that can distract us easy, right? So we're defending against that, perhaps. It says the breastplate of faith and love, helmet of the hope of salvation. It's like, okay, well, what does that mean we do then? Well, ultimately, that means that we take hope and faith in our coming Savior. We're saved, right? So we remember that. We keep that in mind. And we have love. This is where it all keeps coming back to love. So what we ultimately do is we focus on what's important to keep ourselves from focusing on what's not. That's ultimately where we're going there. Now, I have to go back to Star Wars. You always have to. If you guys have not seen episodes 4 through 6, I don't know who you are. It's just, and I'm sorry, I'm going to spoil things then in that case. But if we make this connection first, so this metaphor works, I'm going to click the button. There we go. Consider this. The dark side equals the world. Let's just establish that first. Okay? So you come into the dark side, it means you're getting sucked into the world. It means you're getting distracted from what's actually important. Okay, so we'll make that connection here. Now, in episode 5, what happens is Luke Skywalker is on Bespin, the floating city, which who knows how physics work with that, but he's up there, and he goes and has a fight with Darth Vader. Darth Vader and him get on this catwalk, for whatever reason that exists, and Darth Vader cuts off Luke's arm, or his hand, I guess. And he basically says, he spills the beans and says, "Luke, I am your father." And Luke is like, "No, that's not true." And he does this whole thing. But Darth Vader tempts him at this point. He's like, "Okay, come to the dark side. I got this deal you can't resist. You join me and we'll overthrow the Emperor and rule the galaxy." So he's got this deal out there. He's like, "Yeah, you want to do that?" Luke's just kind of listening to this. And eventually he dodges the question by just jumping off the catwalk. So he saves that answer for a different day. Episode 6. Somehow he also survives. I don't quite understand that. But in episode 6, Darth Vader now. Okay. Darth Vader and the Emperor are like, "Okay, we need to try this again. Here's attempt two. We're going to really get him this time. We're going to tag team him. Okay, we're going to really tempt him to the dark side, okay?" So they have this plan, except that Luke also has a plan in this. Luke turns himself in the first place, but he has a plan. His plan is to convert his father back to the, I guess, light side, you could say. And the question is why? Well, the only reason I can come up with why he'd want to bring his father back to the light side is because he loves him. So now how we're talking about breastplate of love, focusing on what's important? We know in the New Testament it says love God and love others. It's the only commandments like really given in the New Testament, so it's obviously important, love. So he's putting this focus now on love for his father as he's going into the situation with Darth Vader and the Sith Lord Emperor. Anyway, so they show up, and the Emperor is tempting him, trying to get him to the dark side, but he resists. And, you know, George Lucas is probably not his intention, that this is why he was able to resist and such, but I like to believe this, that it's because Luke had this love for his father. He had a focus on what was important that didn't let the Sith distract him into what wasn't. And as you guys know, for those of you who've seen it, the Emperor, with his not success there, decides to pump tons of voltage through Mr. Luke and try to kill him. But the Darth Vader, of course, sees his son getting electrocuted and is like, "No, I won't stand for that." So he picks the Emperor up and throws him off that tall thing or whatever it was. I don't know. And again, you're led to believe that Darth Vader saw his son getting electrocuted and he was like, "That's not cool. Like, that's my son, and that's why he said." But I think it's more than that. I think, this is what, again, what I like to believe, at least. I think Darth Vader, or when Luke showed up, he had this focus on love. He did not conform to the world, and that set a great example to his father. And that maybe because of that, his father went, "I want to be back to the light side. I want that again." Because certainly, we as Christians, if we stay unconformed and we show love, put on that armor, we certainly shine to those who are in the darkness. Just saying. And I think it's very touching at the very moment. If you guys remember, Luke pulls off Darth Vader's helmet, right, because he's dying. And he says, "I need to get you out of here. I need to save you." And Darth Vader says, "You already have." And it's like, yes. Sorry. It's super cheesy, I know. But I love that connection. I feel like that's what really happened there. Anyway, so like I said, it all seems to come back down to love. The idea that if you focus on what's important, like love, loving others, you can avoid from getting tempted and stuck in the world and thinking that trivial matters are so much bigger than they actually are. Now, there's this video that, with the help of John, Cody, and Nick, already you know it's going to be cheesy based on those names, right? they helped me make this video that I think reemphasizes the points about this message. So just to give you a little bit of background, it's like, I guess you call the video, or I call the video, God Glasses, because it centers on these glasses that when you put them on, you suddenly see through God's eyes, you see what's really important and what's not. And it kind of has to do this with this fun thing where you got Cody and Nick in the supermarket and they're trying to get a phone that there's only one in stock. So there's, you know, kind of some rambunctiousness. But it's a quick 4.5 minute video. And after that, I'm going to pray to end service and we'll be done here shortly. But if we can get that video going, get it pulled up, you guys can savor the cheesiness. Oh, and if we could go and hit the lights, that would be great too.
So, Cody, tell me about you.
Well,
this is Cody. Cody makes regular trips to his counselor, discuss things that he obsesses over, and considers a big deal. His counselor, on the other hand, understands the trivial nature of Cody's obsessions.
I realize I hate trains. Oh, I hate it.
Okay, Cody, I'm going to stop you right there. All right, I think what you need here is a new perspective on things. Luckily, I can get you in on a clinical trial that'll give you a new perspective.
All right.
It's called God Glasses. Anytime you start feeling like you're thinking about trivial matters a little too much, you just put these on and it'll give you a whole new perspective on things.
Thanks, Doc.
I suggest you sleep in tomorrow and take it easy.
No, I can't do that, no. See, there's this really smoking hot deal that is going on tomorrow morning. It's going to be kind of like the Black Thursday deal. And it's this awesome phone. I just absolutely have to have it. I can't miss that. No way.
Hey, Cody.
Hey, what's up? What are you doing here?
Dude, I'm here to get this new phone. There's only one in stock. I gotta make sure that I'm the one that gets it. It's got all these awesome features. I can't even believe it is so awesome. Wait, you're here for it too, aren't you?
Hey, thanks for waiting, guys.
This really be it? The one true phone? Wait a second.
Give me that thing, dude! It's mine! Come on!
I need it!
Come on, give it to me!
The phone! My phone!
That phone is mine!
Nick, why? How could you have done that? Wait a second. Am I looking at this all wrong? Nick, I love you. Dude, like, I didn't know you. You should get some coffee sometime.
So I know it's super cheesy, but it's certainly fun filming with Cody and Mick and John. It's always fun stuff to do that. Anyway, I'm going to go ahead and close this out. So go ahead and bow your head, close your eyes. There we go. Yeah. Dear God, I pray as we go on about our weeks and in our lives, God, help us remember how easy it is to get stuck in our day-to-day activities, to just go through the motions. Help us remember that. Remember that you are so big, God, and there's so much going on, that help us focus on what we're here for and to just love on people and put on the armor to keep us from getting stuck in the things of the world, God. Keep us away from those temptations that you got. And I pray as we leave here today that we'd all have fellowship together and all love on each other, just like Cody did there with Nick. Thank you, God. Amen. All right, guys, that was a little early, but you guys are dismissed.